We have a guest joining us on the program who, let me just attest, I get to know people through the job sometimes. Even before she thought about running for lieutenant governor, I had gotten to know Janice McGee, and she's a business owner from Idaho Falls, a very successful business owner, and she served 5 terms in the state legislature as well. And you don't often get to say this about people in politics, but she is one of the nicest persons you could meet who is running for political office. She's not one of those candidates who will blow smoke at you just to tell you what you want to hear while she's campaigning. It's 7:33 on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com, and we're at 49. Bill Colley with you as well on Magic Valley this morning. And first of all, we'd like to say welcome back to our program to Janice McGeehan. Long time no see.
Oh, Bill, thank you so much for your kind words. I appreciate that so much, and it's really great to be able to be on your radio program again this morning. I'm sorry that I wasn't able to be there in person, and I hope that next time we'll be able to have a in-house radio interview.
Well, yeah, and that's the thing about campaigning is sometimes you get tied up in certain places and your schedules have to change, and it's like turning on a dime, isn't it?
Absolutely, and yesterday I had a full day in Boise, but good news is I'm heading into your neighborhood this afternoon. There's a nice event for me this evening in Twin Falls area. And then tomorrow night I'll be back in Twin Falls for the fair, the Twin Falls County Fair. Hopefully I'll get to see you then.
Yeah, in fact, I think you're going to be part of our live show at the fair tomorrow between 5 and 7 p.m. But this gives you a chance as well to walk the fairgrounds and actually, you know, listen to some of the people who are at the fair about what their needs and concerns are.
Yes, and I'm looking forward to doing that. As I cross all over our great state of Idaho, we love Idaho, we love America, great country to live in and a great state. It's so nice to speak with Idahoans all over that share the values of hard work, honesty, and personal responsibility. I think those are three concepts that we all, as conservatives and traditional individuals in Idaho, share. And those things, no matter what we do in life, if we apply those three principles, we'll be successful.
I was just reading online, I think this morning, one of the Republican Party committees, this one in Kootenai County, made a large contribution to your campaign. And the writer said this follows Canyon County doing the same. So I'm guessing that people are getting behind at the party level, getting behind the campaign. And clearly, this is not an easy thing to do, to run for office, because you have to move from place to place, 44 counties. This is a big geographic state. All of these contributions are certainly welcome, I would assume.
Absolutely. And then also my hometown county, Bonneville County, made a substantial contribution to my campaign. And that is so meaningful to me. I am seeing that more and more, the growing support for my campaign, and for my friends and colleagues that are also running as Republican candidates. And it's so important that we all stick together and support each other in this upcoming general election. As I spoke to the Region 7 banquet last weekend, we came out of a difficult primary because, in large part, there were a lot of good people running for different offices, and it was competitive. And it's not easy to do that, put yourself out there and not be successful. I recognize that. But we got out early and worked hard all across the state. And for all of us across the state, as Republicans, we may each identify with a different shade of red on the color spectrum, but we're all red. And we're red Republicans because we share the idea, the belief that the strength of our nation lies in our reliance and faith in God, our Creator, the individual and the family, the traditional family. We believe that life begins at the moment of conception, and that the protections granted to us by our Creator are unalienable rights. And we believe in the free enterprise system, that's the best way for economic prosperity and success. Those are shared values that we have as Republicans, but not everyone shares those same principles, and they believe that the government has a different role in our lives than we as Republicans. No. Those individuals want to change our state, our great state of Idaho, to a blue state. And so it's really important that we all work together and support each other in the general election and work to help keep Idaho blue. I mean red, sorry.
I don't think actually though that you have to worry about the change coming anytime soon. I was joking with one of your supporters the other day on air. I said, you know, I've read the name of your opponent in this race from the other party, the other major party, a few times, but I said, it's not anything that I remember. I'm in the middle of all of this, and I can't even remember your opponent's name. And then I read the other day, polling data shows that the top of that ticket has not budged. Its support might be a quarter of the people polled, and it's not moving. So I know that from a political standpoint, you look at this and you say you don't take anything for granted. But let's be honest, when you're out campaigning, you've got a huge advantage just in voter registration.
That's true. But also, you know, we need to just, I'm not taking this, my campaign, for granted. I'm working just as hard for the general election as I did with the primary election, because people want to be heard. They want to have their voice be heard. And it's why it's so important for me to continue to get out across the state and listen to the people of Idaho. And there's some real differences in the qualifications between myself and my opponent. I've worn a lot of different hats in my life. I'm a wife, I'm a mother, I'm a small business owner. We've created jobs in five different industries. We provide good paying jobs with benefits to over 50 families in Idaho. So the 30 plus years of business administration experience that I have, plus the 10 years of legislative experience, understanding policy and knowing sometimes the unintended consequences of laws that are put into place. I have that experience, and I have established relationships with members of the legislature, and those are qualifications for the position, the unique position of the lieutenant governor, who presides over the Senate during session and then works with the governor to help administer the executive branch of government.
I was going to say, though, I think your opponent's background in business is painting pottery or something along those lines. So, 7:41, our guest is Janice McGee, and she's the Republican nominee for lieutenant governor in the state of Idaho. We're at 47. Bill Colley with you on Magic Valley this morning on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. You know, when you talked about how it's just different shades of red in the Republican Party, I mentioned this on the air a couple of weeks ago. Yes, there are factions within the party, but we actually have, if you're looking at something you could call a unity ticket, you've got Brad Little, who is he's respected in the agricultural community, and he's well known in Boise, and some people might call him an establishment candidate. And then we've got you, who I don't know that you were ever really considered to be any sort of a maverick in politics, but you bring in a lot of people who may have felt over the years that they were a little disenfranchised by the Republican Party. But working together, you can sort of build that coalition.
Absolutely. And that's the beauty of the Republican ticket, because we are very diverse and we represent the diverse interests of our great state of Idaho. Brad Little is a rancher and a farmer. My background is in small business, and we do collectively represent the full spectrum within our party, and that's important because all of those considerations need to be thought of when we're administering government and helping to solve the problems of our state.
Now, when people are, you know, I mentioned earlier, you've got a couple of significant campaign contributions from some fellow Republicans this past week or so. If people would like to actually contribute to the campaign, what would you tell them to do?
I would ask those who would like to support my campaign financially to go onto my website, Janice for Idaho, and there's a donate button there. You can easily make a financial contribution to my account, and I would greatly appreciate that, because it does take dollars to continue to get the message out through social media, buying additional signs and brochures, and have some money to do some radio spots across the state. I would really appreciate your financial support. I do believe that my opponent has been lobbying outside Democratic policy lobby groups to bring some money into her campaign. We won't know all of this until the first campaign disclosure report comes out there, but she is soliciting outside dollars from Blue Act, which is a liberal, progressive liberal Democratic source of funding.
We wanted to point out, too, as well, when you referenced the fact it costs money to campaign, I just read today that we have the fifth highest gasoline prices in the country right now. So when you have to visit 44 counties and you're traveling back and forth up and down the highways, it probably would have been a lot cheaper to campaign a year ago than it would be today.
Well, I mean, those gas prices hit all of us hard in our budget. It's really tough to absorb that kind of increase in gas prices and what we're seeing it with our health care costs. There's so many things that we are being challenged with today, and I look forward to working hand in hand with the members of the legislature to help solve some of these problems, make health care more affordable for all Idaho citizens, help solve some of the challenges that we have in education with helping to prepare our kids for their future. That's the bottom line of what we should be doing in education. And it's not always the one-size-fits-all approach going straight on to college. There's a lot of opportunity that we can do to give these young people skills while they're in high school so that they can work right, get the training that they need while they're in school, earn credit for that, and then when they graduate, there are some really great jobs that are available for these kids.
Hold that thought. We've got to take a break for the Rush Morning Update, but we've got more coming up with Republican Janice McGeehan on KLIX. Oh, no, there's some music. I guess that's from the Democrat Party. Yeah, they all walk around, they're 8 feet tall, and they're dressed like Darth Vader. Be very wary of them when it comes Election Day. 10 minutes now away from 8 o'clock, our guest is Janice McGeehan. She's the Republican candidate for Lieutenant Governor in Idaho. By the way, for those people who'd like to talk to her this morning, be patient because she's going to be with us until 8:30. And we're at 49. Bill Colley on Magic Valley this morning on News Radio 1310, KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. I do want to get back to something that she was just addressing before the break, and we were having a discussion about vocational education. And how we've got to start maybe thinking more along those lines that not everybody is college track, and how we could better expand opportunities for people who have skills but don't necessarily want to go into debt by hundreds of thousands of dollars to get a degree in English literature. First of all, I almost called you governor already. We should point out that lieutenant governor, the official form of address, is governor as well. But I can't do that. I'd be jumping the gun just a wee bit. So we'll call you representative. Or was it senator that was your last office?
Well, I was a state representative, and I'm focusing on this election. I got to get through this next election first, and then I'll be able to serve as lieutenant governor. And I'm really looking forward to that day and working to help solve a lot of the challenges that we have in Idaho. And on that line, our topic of vocational training, I'd just like to share with the listeners about our personal experience as small business owners. And I'm sure that there are a lot of other businesses throughout the state that can identify with this challenge that we have as business owners. And that is that we are only hampered by the growth in our business by our sometimes lack of ability to find skilled workers to do the job. Last October, we bought a new building. We're in the automotive business. We have a repair shop that we repair transmissions. And last October, we bought a new building because our business was growing. We were running out of space. We needed a new location. So we found a great opportunity, bought the space, and it has about twice the number of bays that we had in our former location. But we can't fill up all those bays with work. The work is there. We have vehicles that are parked in our parking lot. It's a full house parking lot. But we just can't get those vehicles into the shop and into the bays to be worked on because we don't have the skilled mechanics to do the job. So there's and in our restaurant as well, there's lots of opportunities in vocational training to do, you know, teach people how to be sous chefs, teach them how to be bartenders, and even in your neck of the woods, the dairy producers, there's opportunities to start working with our kids in high school and give them these skills so that they'll be able to help the business community when they graduate from high school. And there's lots of opportunities that are available. And it's just a matter, we don't have to recreate the wheel. We don't have to create a new government program for this. It's just a matter of making that connection between the educational institution and the business community. And it should all be tailored to fit the needs of each community because we all have different needs throughout the state.
You know, you bring that up. I was on the tour at the Sierra Mine in Wallace about 6 weeks ago, and the tour guide is fantastic. He's a retired miner. He spent, I think, 33 years in the mining industry, but he explained that what they used to do, because the mining positions paid very, very well 40, 50 years ago, that a lot of young people were quitting school so they could go to work in the mines. So the mining companies came to a decision, and what they decided to do was set up classrooms in the mines. And they literally have a historic classroom in there where they show you what it looked like inside that particular mine. And the students would come out to the mine, and they'd get some classroom teaching instruction, not only in you know, the regular subjects, but in mining as well. And so they would then graduate, and then they would go directly to work in the mine after graduation. And I thought, we don't have a lot of programs like that anymore, but they got a good rounded education. And when they finally started in the mines, no one had to, you know, spend a couple of months training them on how to do the job and safety and the like. They were prepared immediately when they took the job.
That's perfect. That is just a perfect example of how it can work to benefit both the students and the business, no matter what the industry is. There's just, you know, what we've gone to in the last, decade, it started with George Bush with the No Child Left Behind, and then it kind of morphed into Common Core. This thought process that we have to teach a certain standard to every student and meet these certain academic standards, and that's what we've been focusing on education. And it's not that those standards are not important. They are important, but our kids learn different ways, and it's the goal, as I stated before, the goal should be, education should be all about preparing our students for their future. That's what our goal in education should be. And whether it's the academic route or this other route where we work with them and teach them skills to go right into a trade, it should be what works best for the student. And we, as a society, should encourage and facilitate that as much as possible. After they get a basic level of skill and could go on and work in the industry, they could go through their apprenticeship training, and then after serving as an apprentice for 5 years, they would move on to be considered a master of their trade. And they can either stay in that industry and earn good wages. I know some of these kids right out of high school are earning $15, $20 an hour. There's a steel manufacturing company over here in Caldwell that they pay $25, $30 an hour for their welders. They make good money while they're doing this, but the other beauty of this track is that most likely those individuals, if they are going to start up a small business, they will do it through that track and start up their own small business and then go on to hire more people and create more jobs. So it's just a compound effect of a good policy that I would like to support and build that up in Idaho.
Yeah, I just recall when I was in high school and I said I didn't think I would ever have a use for algebra, and my teacher kept insisting I would. And you know what? I was right. So it has nothing to do with what I do for a living or what I chose to do for a living.
Yeah.
Hey, we've got a review again. Your website for people who'd like to know more about you and the campaign.
Okay, it's Janice for Idaho. Just can go online and learn a little more about my campaign, my positions, a little bit more about my personal life. And I welcome your support. I welcome your feedback. And most important, I ask for your vote on November 6th to become your next lieutenant governor.
We wanted to point out you'll be with us through the next half hour. I mentioned that on air, and I didn't actually confirm that with you, so I hope that you can stay. We might be able to take some calls from some of the folks tuning in this morning after 8 o'clock news. And we do want to mention, too, as well, Janice McGeehan will be at the Detweiler Farm tonight, not too far away from our radio studios. All right, okay, the other side of the city. But I look at that and say it's not too far away when you consider all of the mileage she's racking up this summer. But that's going to be off Pole Line Road near the intersection of North 2700 East and Pole Line, about a half mile north of the Sunway Soccer Complex in Twin Falls. And I've got a map here in front of me, and I really can't explain that over the radio for people, but I've got to thank Adrian Arp for dropping off the map with me yesterday at the Twin Falls County Fair. And, of course, candidate Janice McGeehan will be at the fair tomorrow. She's also going to be appearing on our program tomorrow night live at the fair. That's taking place between 5 and 7 p.m. So you'll have plenty of opportunities, whether it be tonight at the Detweiler Farm to meet her or even tomorrow at the fair. We've got one more half hour coming up with the candidate following the news at 8 o'clock. Also wanted to point out, we've got, I believe, Dan Tom joining us from the Twin Falls County Sheriff's Department just after 8:30 this morning. Bill Colley with you on News Radio 1310, KLIX, and NewsRadio1310.com. Our guest is Janice McGeehan. She is a Republican running for lieutenant governor in Idaho. We're 6 minutes after 8 o'clock. We're at 51 on Magic Valley this morning with Bill Colley on News Radio 1310, KLIX, and NewsRadio1310.com. She's going to be spending a couple of days in Twin Falls. She's going to be doing a meet and greet tonight at the Detweiler Farm just off Pole Line Road, and she's going to also be visiting the Twin Falls County Fair, where we'll see her tomorrow during our live show there between 5 and 7 p.m. at the Republican Party booth. I do want to point out the first time I ever met candidate McGeehan, I was a guest at her restaurant. I was there for lunch one day, and I told her how nice she lives in Idaho Falls, and I told her how nice Idaho Falls was. She kind of looked at me for a moment. She said, "Yeah, but you have a canyon." I just so leads me to believe you like visiting Twin Falls.
Yeah, you do have a beautiful city as well. Jimmy and I had lunch there a couple of weeks ago, overlooking the canyon. It was just astoundingly beautiful. But that's what I love so much about Idaho is we have so many beautiful places all across the state.
You had a fellow tell me yesterday he's going to sit. He'll drive me down to Niagara Springs in the canyon one of these days, because even though I don't live very far from it, I've never been there. So I'm trying my best, but it's such a big state, it may take me another decade to get to all of these places.
Yeah. I had a really neat tour of the Idaho National Laboratory on Monday, and we have such a great gem there in that laboratory. One of the things we toured, it's called the Center for Advanced Energy Science. And it's a great example of a collaborative effort between the three universities, BSU, U of I, ISU, the state of Idaho, and the federal government. They conduct a lot of research, and it's a place that has some really cool equipment and students. From this summer in Idaho Falls, we had five of the top students from Stanford University that are studying engineering. They came out, but one of the experiences, they took us into this cave, and someone had done a flyover of your neck of the woods over there at Hegerman Springs, and it was just amazing what these students did. They did a flyover in an airplane, and using laser technology, they were able to plot out the land. They showed us a plateau, a ledge over there that had started to sink down. You could see how the ledge was, you know, quite a bit below there going into the canyon. And they plotted this and we put on these 3D glasses, and you could see just through these little dots that they built a computer program, we could see the landscape, we could see the trees, we could see the circular irrigation plan there at some of the farmland. And they were able to really study what was causing this plate to kind of drop down, and it was because of some excess water that was coming down, flowing down. There was a visible waterfall, and it would fill up this lake. But it was that was causing this plate to kind of sink down. It was really cool to be able to see that visually. And we, like I said, we had our 3D glasses on, and we could, it was just like you were there flying over it. And it was really cool to see.
Yeah, but you didn't have to deal with the triple-digit temperatures in Hagerman that day.
No.
We wanted to point out. Our guest is Janice McGee, and she is running for lieutenant governor as a Republican in the state of Idaho. And again, she'll be at the Twin Falls County Fair tomorrow, and she's also going to be at the Detweiler Farm tonight in Twin Falls. That's a meet and greet that she has scheduled. 10 minutes after 8 o'clock, we're at 46 on Magic Valley this morning. Bill Colley with you, too, on News Radio 1310 KLIX. And newsradio1310.com. If you'd like to speak to the candidate, if you've got a question or comment for her, 208-736-0300, 208-736-0300. I should point out, you mentioned the universities in Idaho earlier and how they do a lot of collaborative projects, but you are definitely, I think, a dyed-in-the-wool vandal. And when you went to the National Republican Convention a couple of years ago, you made sure everyone there knew that.
That's right. I smuggled in a vandal flag, and we had it on full display on the convention floor. I was wanting to let both of our kids, James and Liza, went to school there. My husband Jimmy went to school up there at University of Idaho, so it was just there to support the vandals. But then the next day there was a person that brought a Boise state flag, and that was cool too.
I'd agree. We have a caller looking to join us. Caller, you're on the air with Janice McGee, and go ahead.
Hi. I just want to add some information for tonight's event, the meet and greet. We're also having lots of fruit pie and ice cream, so it's a great opportunity to meet this wonderful candidate and come and have some fun and have some delicious dessert. And I want you to know that there will be a sign on pull line that has Jen's McGee sign, so it'll be easy to find.
Directions are good.
Huh?
Directions are very good.
Anyways, I thought I'd have a question for Janice. I was talking to some gentlemen yesterday at the fair booth, and they just were concerned on your ability to work with Brad Little. And I thought that you have so much experience working with all sorts of people, government level, business level, that you would be a perfect fit probably. But I'd like to hear your opinion on that. And also, again, just come tonight, bring your friends. We're going to have a great time. It's from 6 to 7 at the Detweiler Farm. And I'm baking pies. All right. Thank you.
Good question.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate your hospitality, and I can't wait to get over there and meet you and some of your friends and neighbors over there. So thank you so much for that. And to your question, how will I believe that Brad Little and I will make a great partnership. The job of managing our state is a big job. We each have different skills to bring to the table, different experiences in life. And because of my 10 years of serving in the legislature, I learned how to work with others that may not, we don't always agree on everything, but we learn how to work with each other in a respectful manner. And that's the beauty of serving in the legislature, is that you learn how to have respectful, courteous debate with those who don't share the same points of view. And I think that sadly is what we're lacking in our society today. We just need to have more civil debate and conversation and respect each other, respect the differences that we have, but find ways to work with others that sometimes have differing opinions. And I did help preside over some of the most difficult times of our state. After the 2008 financial crisis, our state was still not building back the tax revenues. The economy wasn't building back to where it needed to be, and so we had to make a decision. Is the legislature going to cut spending, or will there be a tax increase? And we collectively made a decision that we would cut government spending, and I was responsible for finding a $20 million in state tax dollars to cut out of our Medicaid budget, and it was really tough. That's a tough place to be, but we worked collaboratively with members of the minority party. We worked with the Department of Health and Welfare. We worked with the governor's office, and we worked with the advocates to find ways to do across-the-board cuts that would not have big impacts to any particular program. And so I have the experience. I know how to do that. It's a big responsibility to manage our state. And we both will bring the experience in life to do a very effective job.
You know, I was at the Twin Falls County Fair yesterday, and I saw walk by one of my former coworkers was staffing the Democrats' booth at the fair, and they had a big sign up for Medicaid expansion. That's going to be a huge issue this coming election day. And do you think this is a good or bad idea?
Well, before I answer that question, I wanted to follow up on my statements prior. And it's important to work with others across the board and find solutions, but without compromising on the principles that we believe in. And I was able to do that. I was able to go home with a feeling of integrity that I fought for the principles that I believe in for our Republican platform. So that's important, and I'm not going to forget that in my role if I become the next lieutenant governor. To answer the question about the Medicaid initiative, what that is it's important for people to understand that this is an expansion of Obamacare in our state. It's simply that I do have a concern about that there is no funding mechanism for this expansion of Obamacare. Already our school budgets are being consumed by the Medicaid dollars without expanding the program. So I have concern that there's no funding mechanism for this plan. But I want to focus my efforts on helping to reduce healthcare costs and make healthcare affordable for all of us, no matter what spectrum you lie in the financial, whatever your financial situation is. We all need to have help in that area in having lower healthcare costs and bending that cost curve, because when over the years, the healthcare spending as a percentage of our GDP has grown from 5% back in the 60s to now it's 18% of our GDP. And by the time we spend half of our family wage to help pay for healthcare for our family, and then we pay 50% in taxes, there ain't much left for anything else. And so I think that's where we need to focus our conversation instead of on the shell game of who's going to pay for this health care. We need to focus on reducing the cost curve and helping to lower health care costs for all Idahoans.
And you know, we should run up, just getting back to Brad a little for a moment. We've got about a minute and a half before the break. When you were serving in the legislature, you had some overlap. He was serving in the legislature as well. So you two already had some familiarity, I'm sure, at the time.
Yes. Yep. He was serving in the Senate when I served in the House.
And people I know who served alongside him during that era have said very nice things about him as an individual, including Michelle Stennett. So that came from the other side of the aisle. It seems to me that he's more than willing to work with anybody himself. And so I think that's a plus for the two of you, is the fact that you both come at this looking at this as a team effort.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, people of Idaho deserve that. They deserve that from their leadership to have, even though, as I said, even though sometimes we differ on our policy position, people deserve to have representation, you know, across the board from our differing views, and find ways to solve the problems that work best for Idaho and not being dictated to us from Washington, D.C.
We've got a short break. We've got more coming up with Janice McGee, and she, of course, is a candidate for lieutenant governor in Idaho. It's 20 minutes after 8:47 on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. Big thank you to Dr. Jonathan Tripp, who visited with us yesterday. One of the representatives from his office is going to be back next Wednesday between 8:30 and 9 o'clock right here on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. And I do want to point out the doctor is still looking for new patients. And as a patient of Dr. Tripp and the staff, they can generally see you on the very same day if you call in the morning with a medical issue. But if not, they'll try and see you within 24 hours. His office is on Fillmore Street in Twin Falls on the north side, across from the post office. And remember, life's too short not to feel good. A balmy 49 at our studios, but on our way somewhere near 80 degrees today. Got a few minutes left with Janice McGee, and she is a Republican and, well, the Republican nominee for lieutenant governor in the state of Idaho. Election day is only about, 10 weeks away, maybe a little under that now, getting closer and closer. And she will be at the Twin Falls County Fair tomorrow. She's going to be joining us during our broadcast between 5 and 7 p.m. She's also going to be doing a meet and greet tonight at the Detweiler Farm, just off Poline Road, just outside of Twin Falls. So she's very, very busy in these waning days of the campaign. Well, say waning days. Well, I guess we'll say that right after Labor Day, but we're getting down to crunch time. And do want to point out you're listening to Magic Valley this morning on News Radio 1310 KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com with Bill Colley. It's 8:22. We cracked 50. It's at 51. We're talking a little bit about that. When I was at the fair yesterday, one thing that I noticed as I was walking the grounds is there's a lot of displays from, you know, various businesses that have some space at the fair every year. It's been a pretty good run for business in the state of Idaho over the last few years. And I would say that an argument you would make as a Republican would be there's no reason now to change horses in midstream.
Well, I want to continue working with leaders across the state to build on this enthusiasm that we're experiencing in our economy in Idaho and across the nation. This was one of the things that inspired me to run for the position when, during the 2016 presidential election, our current president, under the current Trump administration, we have seen almost a 50% reduction in corporate income tax rates. And through, by executive order, our president has repealed layer upon layer upon layer of burdensome regulation, so that what we're seeing now is a renewed enthusiasm within our business community and they're being able to thrive under the atmosphere of lower taxes and less regulation. And that's my philosophy, is that I believe that the less government is best. We get the government off of our back, and we will be able to thrive as individuals, small business owners, farmers, ranchers, whatever your lot in life is. With the heavy hand of government off our backs, we will be able to prosper and thrive. And so I'm excited about that. I'm excited about what I see happening in our state and the economic growth. I mean, we have almost a 4.1% growth in GDP in the last year and a half under the Trump administration. That's amazing. On the prior years under the prior administration, we would sometimes barely see a 1-2% growth in the economy. And so we have record low unemployment rates, an increase in the labor participation across the country. It's astounding the path that we're on. We don't need to change that. It's a good path, and we will keep that momentum.
You talk a little bit about regulation, and I've been reading that there's going to be some changes made in how we tackle wildfires and the policy behind that. Just as a side note, I was visiting in a neighboring state last week, and I drove through a forested area where I'd say two-thirds of the trees are just plain dead. They're just big, tall matchsticks waiting to go up. That's no different than in what we see in many parts of Idaho as well. We need to have a change in that policy as well, because that's becoming such a disruption to our lives every summer.
Yeah, and the whole land use issue is really important to our state, and we need to be able to preserve our resources, but be able to go out and actively manage those resources. People wonder why our rural communities are hurting and suffering so much, because we can't. There's no more logging. There's no more mining. The grazing rights are being shut down, and we have been blessed with these amazing natural resources. Nobody can do a better job of managing those resources than the people of Idaho. So we need to protect and preserve those resources, maintain the public access to our lands. Over the years and the prior administrations, there's just been a continual shutdown and a lack of access to our lands. And I have some ideas of what we can do to maintain that public access to our lands and have more of a hand in actively managing those resources.
And I was going to say, the President and Secretary Zinke have signaled that they're perhaps more than willing to give the state a little more control over some of that federal land. I don't know that that'll happen anytime soon, but you know, when I think about people who live in some of these smaller counties where they have no tax base simply because they have so little control over the land that is in their county boundaries, we've got to start thinking about people maybe as well as all of the small animals and critters that live out there.
Well, it will happen when I become the Lieutenant Governor of Idaho, because it is time that we as a state begin to assert our sovereignty as a state and have more authority and role in making those decisions here in Idaho rather than the bureaucrats back in Washington, D.C.
We're going to take a very quick telephone call. We've only got about 3 minutes to go. Caller, you're on the air with Janice McGee and on KLIX.
Yes. I was talking to my son the other day, and this happened in Montana. They closed all the Beaverhead or land all along the Beaverhead River up there. The BLM did, and turned around and then sold all the mineral rights to the oil companies and basically locked up the land. And I don't want that kind of nonsense to happen in Idaho. Thank you. Bye.
I want to thank you for the call.
I appreciate that call. There's hope out there. We're looking at the state of Utah is looking at a proposal to start reclaiming some of those BLM lands, and I'm anxious to hear within a few weeks a decision that's made there in Utah, and we can follow suit here in Idaho.
I was going to say we've got about a minute and a half to go. Just a quick note, one of your, I think, probably primary backers and one of your earliest supporters, Bjorn Handeen, has a birthday today. I just see this. I'm perusing my internet
here.
Thanks
for the heads up there. I'll have to give him a birthday wish.
The reason I knew that his county committee had contributed to your campaign is because he made it pretty clear on Facebook in the last 24 hours.
Bjorn's a great friend, a great supporter, and he traveled all the way from North Idaho along with Brent Regan to come to our Region 7 banquet. That's the enthusiasm and support I'm seeing from Republicans across the state, not just for my campaign, but for all Republican candidates that are on the ticket.
Once again, what's the website?
Janice for Idaho.
And that's a F-O-R and not a number four. That's Janice, F-O-R, Janice
yes,
for Idaho.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Super. We look forward. We'll see you at least, if not tonight, we'll see you tomorrow night at the fairgrounds.
Okay. Thank you so much. It's been a great opportunity to speak with you. And look forward to seeing you, Bill.
All right, take care. Janice McGeehan joining us this morning, Republican candidate for lieutenant governor in Idaho, spending a nice hour with us, giving us an overview on some of her positions. Just quickly, too, wanted to mention Dan Tom is coming up from the Twin Falls County Sheriff's Department in just a moment. But also wanted to mention, too, we still have a couple of months where you're going to be mowing the lawn. And if you're looking to get a mower to really handle a tough job, you could win a brand new Bad Boy mower. This is brought to you by Ruby Mountain Motors on Kimberly Road. You can drive by the Ruby Mountain Motors lot on Kimberly Road and view the mower. It's a zero-turn 48-inch deck, model 4800 ZT Elite. Ruby Mountain Motors carries the best quality used trucks and SUVs that work and play as hard as you do. Stop by and see Josh and the crew at 2135 Kimberly Road in Twin Falls. And the website there is rubymountainmotors.com. You can also find out more about the contest by going to our website, newsradio1310.com. It's 8:30. We're at 50 on News Radio 1310 KLIX.